Brother Banks brought him to the Army. You had to actually go and apply to join the Savio Club. And in my case, I went to Brother Bent and I said, Brother, could I join the Savio Club? And I remember the words. He said, you're not the type of boy we want in the Savio Club. To the Savio Club were Brother Ben's private army, private little police force, I should say. And they were told to inform on any boy that had might have had impure thoughts or dropped a magic word or something like this. So that was the Dominic Savio Club. The Dominic Savio Club were even worse than the Gold Club. So you can imagine they were the lowest of the low. So if you were in the Gold Class and in the Savio Club, come here, Dixon, come on, hands up on the table, we're seeing Dixon, come on, up there, that's it. Gentlemen, we're reaching the stage here. This is a little thing I've titled Salute to a Few. I hope there aren't any names, Danny, out of...
Hello, what's your name?
Father Fire.
Are you looking for a husband?
Because there are plenty of available husbands here. One's even got his first letter for £10 notes. And if you don't believe me, Tommy, show the lady your £10 notes. Come on. This is the salute to the few. This list is not meant in any way to detract from the blokes who represented us at war, in the police, or other tasks in the line of duty. Nor does it detract from those who have excelled in their chosen trades or professions. Firstly, we have Tony, you might stand up. Tony Mustiga, OAM. Tony Mustiga rose above huge adversity to obtain his permission today. He's gone from being a migrant kid with no previous English, who was flogged because he'd arrived late for school whilst his dad went to the fruit markets to collect the daily stock for the shop. Little did we, or the brothers, or did he envisage some 50 years later he'd be the deputy mayor of Willoughby City Council, as that's his position today. Tony's had leading positions in the Department of Education. He left school at age 15. He was actually 3 years older than us. He was in our class. He'd repeated, he did fourth class in Italy, fourth class at the Maris Brothers at Mossman, and fourth class at St Pius X, because he didn't speak a ding. He's been a highly successful businessman, and Tony, it's a pleasure to know you, and I'd like you to give Tony a clap. He's not here today, but we also have Rod White AM, who was awarded in 1988 to Major Roderick White for services to the Australian Army Reserve. Amongst numerous other positions, Rod is currently the honorary treasurer of the New South Wales RSL branch. Now, we won't give him a... Okay, here's a second. Eric Cooper. Eric, would you like to stand up? The mighty Eric Cooper. Eric was one of the leading lights of the blue class. Eric was the Australian Amateur Golf Champion in 1982 and was the only bloke from our year to have made front page of the National Sporting Page. Stand up, Eric, you know. Come up here, son. No, I can see you. Eric is the only one to make the front page of the National Sporting Pages. Eric has donated 1 minute to be 1 minute of his time today to help any of you requiring individual coaching with your swing or putting. Gold Class and Savio members also included in this thoughtful offer. Well done, Eric. Greg Johnson, OAM. Stand up. I don't have to expel you a second time. Okay, does this son Greg up, the silent achiever, awarded his medal for services to international education and to the finance industry. Greg, as we know, left SPX in a hurry. I'll leave it up to him to tell you the rest. Greg, of course, has always been the go-to man to resolve any issues and to logically analyse any situation. We're proud to know you, Greg. Paul Kelly. Oh, I would prefer to watch you on TV, Paul. Paul needs no introduction. He's undisputedly Australia's leading political journalist.
Oh, I thought he was the singer.
No.
Undisputedly Australia's leading political journalist and political historian and noted author. He received the 2001 Walkley Award for Journalism Leadership, plus numerous other accomplishments, including currently editor-at-large of the Australian newspaper. Paul, it's a pleasure to know you, and thank you. Paul, I do have one disappointment, though. I've often begged you to give me a job within the vast Murdoch empire, to no avail. Maybe just a little column here or there. In your wisdom, you've generally chosen to ignore my email, which the fellows here today are well aware of. But knowing that you're au fait with my electrical skills, I had expected a call from you offering me a position as phone tapper at large. Again, Paul, to no avail. Paul, you may wish to respond.
You'll write a book about it.
Is this the first time any of us have ever witnessed Paul being stuck for words? And of course,
theological column in the Australian, Peter. You can write that.
Of course, last but not least, the mighty Mick O'Brien needs no introduction or encouragement for that matter. Mick was the world's first streaker, as highlighted in Time magazine's photo of the year. You have the beer case to which take home, please, and I have some more if you'd like a set. The beer case on the table to remember Mick's major feat. We hope today that Mick would have replicated his Twickenham deed of April 20, 1974, and to have his stuff across Beecham Oval just down the road later on this afternoon. However, as you glean from the apologies previously read out so graciously by Phil Doherty, that Mick was unable to attend today. We might have just...
Hi guys, and welcome.
Can you turn the microphone on, please?
Speak up. Hi guys, that's really good.
Turn it on.
Get us direct right into it.
We here.
What was that?
It's very natural.
Yeah.
You turn it off again.
And he's in the blue class.
And the blue.
He is to watch Rod Chilli. I think I'll just stand here and wait for it all to happen.
It's still turned off.
No, he's on. He's
no hearing loss. I'm getting any younger. In 2011, we started off a fund for the boys, for everyone, really everyone who's in this room, and for all the boys that aren't here today. It was wonderful. It was started off with $500, and it's now grown to something like about 7,000. haven't got my notes here, so I have to get them out of the bag and tell you exactly what's happening. Just a minute. No, it's got to be got to happen.
No, don't.
Rob, while you're doing that.
Green notes here. Paul's the guy, Paul Murphy is the guy who count, and he's written it all down for me today so I can read it. And it's been really good because I haven't got a clue what's happening here. But anyway, since 2011, deposits from classmates have a total of $9,660. Six payments have been forwarded to Bill and Susie York, totaling $7,000, the most recent being yesterday of $1,000. The flowers have been sent to Mary Tesserira in memory of Alf. $113, and the account balance immediately prior to the reunion collection was $2,547. This reunion will net approximately, but we're looking at $1,000 to $1,200 after paying for our lunch and drinks. And there's a little note from Paul. Rob, that's all I was going to say to the boys, so it's a lot easier if you just include it in your delivery. Anyway, the whole idea of this fund is to help people like the Yorks. The Yorks have had an extremely difficult time. The last time I saw Bill was in February, and the time before that was at David Miko's funeral. Now, at that stage, at David's funeral, Bill could get out a sentence. He was standing up, and he could present to you. Now, Bill has totally nothing to say, but in his mind, he wants to say everything. So, what we want to do today is shoot a video, take some shots, point some names out, and it's all for Bill, really. The $20 that you give doesn't seem a lot, but what it does is fantastic. It gives them everything. And Dennis Byrne, I don't know if he wants to say a few words, but it's the sort of thing where we experienced being with him. It was the most brilliant experience I've ever had. So I'll leave it at that. Thanks very much.
Hey, buddy.
Dean, did you want to speak?
Well, I didn't want to, but now it's been put upon me, I suppose.
You're from the blue class. You've been wearing one of the elites for 20 minutes.
It's going to be a while. Right. Chris is fucking me up again.
Just by chance, I have a very good friend from my younger days where I live, not a schoolmate of ours, who lives at Canowra. I was going out there for some business. However, Canowra is only about 3/4 an hour from Forbes, where Bill's in his home, nursing home. And so I went over to see him. Very easy effort, and I spent roughly a day there. I went there for a couple of hours in the morning. Met his wife, Susie, there. And when I first arrived, I walked into a room which is basically a therapy room, and there's all these people in various stages of disability, and they're doing, they've got videos playing with music and this, that, the other. And the whole room was quite confronting, I guess. You walk in there, I'm feeling great, I'm healthy, I'm lucky, and blah, blah, blah. And there's all a lot of people, and a lot of them not very old either, in various stages. As soon as I walked through the door, which is pretty much on the opposite side of the room, Bill recognised me. And even though he couldn't get out of his wheelchair, he could see his eyes light up and all this, that, and the other. And soon after that, his wife says, "You arrived." But he could barely speak. But when I walked across the room, he tried to get up. And when I got to him, he sort of pushed himself out of his wheelchair. Couldn't speak, and I sort of grabbed him and helped him up, and it was just a big hug. But the feeling in that was not just holding a bloke up, the feeling and the love and emotion that came out of Bill in appreciation was just unbelievable. Anyway, after some time, he went, they had a lunch break. I went into town, had lunch, and Susie couldn't come back, but I had a long talk to her. But in amongst that, he asked Susie, he had a football jersey from North Sydney Bears in a frame, and he asked her, could he bring it and hang it up in his room in the motel home, whatever it was. Anyway, she arranged that, and that could be done. And then I got the idea to, well, you can have a North jersey, surely you can have an old boys jersey from school. Anyway, one thing led to another. I organised the jersey through the Sea Bobs and got people to sign it, this, that, the other, and then Rob and a few others here and others who are not here went out there and for his birthday in the February. What that meant to Bill, even though he couldn't express himself, was unbelievable. And I inadvertently started something which has led to a huge thing, apart from donating money to them already. From all the love and emotion through that, I think I experienced nearly as big a thrill as Bill and Susie and all that did, and I'm sure everybody else involved did. What I didn't know, and I didn't find out until a few months later through speaking to Rob, was that after I got back and wrote a bit of a report of what I'd done and this and the other, and it went out through the through Rob's network, that the fund increased by nearly $1,000 after doing that. Or over $1,000, didn't it? But I think that's just fantastic. And as you say, $20 these days is not much. You can hardly get a couple of drinks for that. But if you're on the other end and a lot of people are putting in, and I have been in circumstances like that myself, and everybody's done a little bit, when you're on the other end of it, it is absolutely unbelievable. It's blown the Yorks away. What it's done for Susie and her kids, and a couple of his sons are also diagnosed with this horrible disease. If you can just imagine looking at your dad in that condition, saying, "That's where I'm going." I don't know how you live with that. However, it's just, it's inexplicable. However, one way or another, we're all going to end up there somehow. Seems I didn't want to say anything. That's
well said. The thing with me is that when Rob sent me that photo of Bill with the jersey on, it hit me so hard that it was not funny. The thing that I actually think was, you know, I've hit 68 and I've had a pretty good time. We spent 9 to 13 years together, every day, lived in each other's pockets, enjoyed the fun and games, enjoyed the sadness and all the rest of it. But that hit me so hard that it was quite amazing, because I didn't think anybody, including the people that have passed away, were any different to me. That I had grown up with all you guys, lived our life, known bits and pieces of everybody's experience, and enjoyed each other's company, that I was really surprised that life had actually dealt that hand to people that I had been with, because I just expected, rightly or wrongly, that everybody would be exactly the same as I am today as what we were when we were 7 or 8. Absolutely no different. So I, for one, would be quite prepared to make either an annual or a monthly sort of contribution, because I guess we're all going to head that way. And one of the things that I did experience, which was some years ago, I hit rock bottom in circumstances that I had no control over, and it was a mate of mine that dragged me out of that, or otherwise it would have been with Alan Miller. And so I'm not asking for you to donate, but I'm asking for the Rob Network to keep us all in touch, and when something goes wrong with any one of us here, that you've got something like 120 people that you can ring that will be on your doorstep tomorrow.
Look, I think before dessert, we do have a little award, and Rod Wills is going to present a little award to his good old mate, Rob Dalton. And then we're just going to have a little prize giving, which is only one item, and that'll be before dessert. And then after that, we'll have the strap auction, and then we'll invite the mob to speak, okay?
Surprise,
I'm
not completed for tomorrow.
Don't
you have one
there? Is it just me, or buying a time warp here? Seeing all you guys again, it's just amazing. But just recounting a couple of things, I was thinking about what I was going to say. In the last year of school, Bob Dalton and I decided that we were no longer boys, that we were men.
What do men do? They go out to the pub and get pissed.
But I said to Bobby, I said, Bobby, it's one small problem. We're only just 17 and we look 15. How are we going to get around this? So now, our Bobby, he's an ideas man. He says, I've got a plan. He said, if we speak with English accents, the publican will surely serve us. So we said, all right. So we hopped on the train at Chatswood and got ourselves into Circular Quay. And we fronted up to the Newcastle pub in George Street, and we practiced our accents outside. I sort of did a cockney, you know, sort of talk like that, you know what I mean, one another pint. And Bob's accent was sort of, well, he was a bit of a Yorkshireman with a speech impediment. So we get into the pub, we're sitting on these two bar stools, jabbering away at each other in these ridiculous accents. And the barman comes up to us. Oh, fuck you. So he looks at us for a while, and then he says, what are you having, lads? I thought, fuck, you bought it. So, Bobby, what are we having? Bobby says, I'll be having a black and tan. I said, oh, what the fuck's a black and tan? That'll be half stout and half ale. Anyway, we got away with it. And I think we owe a lot to our Bobby. I mean, with the winds of time scattering us all over the place, there's been one thread that's kept us all together.
Yeah.
And that's been Bobby. He's kept all our records of where we are and who we are. Has been able to contact us, and it's only given out once every 50 years by papal decree.
God, Finn's been elevated.
Now, this is the St. Leon of the Strap.
I'm
sure many of us were in Grealish's class, and we know who Leon Grealish was. I shall read this award to you all. St. Leon of the Strap, under canon law, article 12, a plenary indulgence is hereby bestowed upon Robert Francis Dalton, by St. Leon, whose power is vested in him by Pope Francis and by Reverend Gordon Kerr, for his efforts in keeping St. Leon's past pupils on the straight and narrow, and for arranging the 50-year class reunion for the classes of LC62 and LC64. Failure to graciously accept this indulgence will ensure that the bestowee will be sent straight to the pool room, along with this indulgence, and given six of the best. Signed under the seal October the 28th, 2014. The seal of St. Leon of the Strap, also known as Grealish the Flogger, Reverend Gordon Kerr, and Pope Francis. Dalton, get down the front.
It's got
the Dalton crest on it.
Look at that.
Oh, well,
that's
good.
Yeah,
we'd all see that, right?
Does the Dalton crest say Fide et Labore?
I do a good chow. On guard, sir. All the boys over that table laughed. This means I can say,
on guard.
Crazy guys. Anyway.
You've turned it off again, Bobby.
Turned it what?
Oh, microphone.
Is that on?
Hey!
Yes!
This really started with Peter McDonald back in 99. And when Peter was on his deathbed, he rang me up and said, can you keep this going? And I said, I guess so. He said, you've got to keep this database going, you've got to keep this feeling going, because what happened in 99 is pretty spectacular. We got all these people together, not only one class, we got three, and wives and everything. It was an event, and it was Peter's swan song. He knew he was dying at that stage, and he wanted to see everyone, and he did it. You know, like, he achieved this with a lot of help from a lot of people. But he rang up, I remember the day that he rang up, there were whales swimming in Sydney Harbour, arrived for the first time in years, probably generations, and these bloody whales turned up swimming around the Opera House. Anyway, Chief Whale, Pete McDonald, rings up and says, hey, I'm just about dying, I'm dead, you know, I just want you to do this for me. And I said, yeah. Not a problem, Peter, I'll keep it going. And that, basically, the award should go to Peter if it goes to anyone. The other Peter, there's all these Peters around. And every time you look around, there's a bloody Peter. If there's not a Michael or a Paul, it's a Peter. And anyway.
Fucking Catholics.
Why do you call him Peter every time Dick
and Harry's called? We've got to give some recognition here to Peter Finch. Now, to dress up like that, like a dickhead, just fantastic. Pedophile. Doesn't it ring a bell? Anyway, Peter's done a magnificent job. He's done a fantastic job. Like, he's retired, he can sit back there and his ass back in Manor Bay and annoy everyone. Ringing up, you know, pestered me every bloody week, bloody teetotaler, complained about the bloody wine of allocation and everything. It really doesn't matter.
Can I drink yours
now? It really doesn't matter. He's a lovely man. And just to complicate things, he's got a broken bloody ankle, and, you know. Yeah, but, you know, got to appreciate it. This boy has done a magnificent job getting people here.
Yeah.
And, The other unsung hero is a guy in count, Paul Murphy, who's given us a report every day of what happens when you add things together, which I know nothing about.
I was in the gold class.
The people who think with the other sides of their brain will get you in the end. Thanks very much, and thanks for the award, guys, and Peter, for all your effort. Brilliant. Thank you.
Thank you.
The Reverend Peter Finn. Can Neville Piper say a few words, Reverend Finn? Sorry, your Reverend Finn.
The outfit's too convincing for me.
That'll work.
That'll work, yeah.
A few words.
That was good, didn't it? Oh, hello. What's your name?
Get out while the going's good.
I can see you've had a few in your day, no? Well, Eric, it's been known that Eric's our most famous sportsman. And some years ago, I was awarded this trophy. It's put out by the Caroma Company, the manufacturers of the toilet systems. It's porcelain, and it's called the Caroma Naga Award, N-A-G-A. It has a goldfish bearing his backside on one side of it, and then you can see a golf club on the other. I was awarded this because the Naga Award stands for not a golfer's asshole. So I've been looking for somebody, and when I knew that Eric was coming, I've been pleased to pass it on because I'm well aware that, Eric, this is one trophy that you've never won. So congratulations, Eric, and I'm proud to have given it to you. Eric is, by the way, came all the way from Griffith to be with us today. He's been living out there for the past 10 years. He was the pro at Mullymook.